Praise God. I will say yes, Lord. I will say yes, Lord. When I read your word, I will say yes, Lord. When I hear the preaching of your word, if it's your word, I'll say yes, Lord. When the Holy Spirit prompts me to do something or prompts me not to do something, I will say yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Let's lift our hands and worship Jesus. The attitude of my heart will be yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. That's going to be how I live my life. I'll say yes, Lord. Let's move around and greet several persons in the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord, everyone. I want you to just turn to one person. Just one. Look at one person. One person. And say to them, it's difficult to love me, but try your best. Say to the person now, you're not so easy to love either, but I'm trying. Let's stand, everyone. We're going to read from the word of the Lord. Amen. We are still looking at pride, the Christian's greatest enemy. We are considering a new lesson, lesson 8. And the topic of this lesson is serving others. One of the ways to eliminate pride from our lives is to sincerely serve others. Notice I say sincerely. We are looking at Philippians. I'm sorry. Seems as if the text has been eaten off at the top of the notes. I'm sorry about that. It's Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. I'm really sorry about that. It's not the devil's fault. Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. And we're going to consider four different translations. The first one is the King James, the second one, the New Living Translation, the third one, the Message, and then the fourth one, an expanded translation. And the fourth one, an expanded translation, is actually this gentleman is, or was, he's dead now, Kenneth Wiest, was a Greek scholar. And in his translation of the New Testament, he tries to bring out as much as is possible all the fullness of the Greek words. Because, you know, we have our English words. We, for instance, use love. And sometimes we're not even sure what we mean by love. One of the things that I find interesting is that a couple will come to me to do premarital counseling, and I might ask them, what's your definition of love? And it's very difficult for them to give me an answer. And just one person summed it up and said, it is better felt than telt. But, for instance, the Greek had more than one word for love, so they would use that word according to the context. So when they spoke about, for instance, the love that a man has for a woman, they would use the word eros. They wouldn't use agape that time. If they were speaking of the love that a man has for a friend, they would use phileo. See what I mean? So they had different words. So this gentleman, Kenneth Wiest, he tries to bring out all the fullness of the words in the Greek. So we'll start with the King James and we'll read responsively right through. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. The New Living Translation. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. The message. If you've gotten anything at all out of following Christ, if his love has made any difference in your life, if being in a community of the Spirit means anything to you, if you have a heart, if you care, don't push your way to the front. Don't sweet talk your way to the top. Put yourself aside and help others get ahead. Well, I'll read this expanded translation for you because it's not in verses. It's taking all four verses. So I'll just read this. In view of the fact that there is a certain ground of appeal in Christ which exhorts, since there is a certain tender persuasion that comes from divine love, in view of the fact that there is a certain partnership on the part of the Spirit, in which the Spirit gives us aid in the living of our Christian life. Since there are certain tender-heartednesses and compassions, fill full my joy by thinking the same thing, by having the same divine self-sacrificial love, being in heart agreement, thinking the one thing, doing nothing impelled by a spirit of factiousness, meaning division, breaking into cliques or sects. You know, I am of Paul, I am of Apollos, I am of Cephas. Nothing motivated by empty pride, but in lowliness of mind, consider one another as excelling themselves. This estimation, resting not upon feelings nor sentiment, but upon a due consideration of facts, not consulting each one his own interests only, but also each one the interests of others. So this last translation, all of this, the reader of Paul's epistle would have understood. So when he spoke about love, he would use the word agape, and they would know that that means a divine self-sacrificial love. They would know that that is what it means. So before you sit, do you kind of get an idea of what Paul was striving for? Do you get an idea of what he was wanting to tell the saints from Philippi? All right, you may be seated. One result of humbling ourselves before the Lord is that our perception of other people will be drastically altered. Once self has been dethroned, we are able to see others in a completely new light. People will become more important to us as we see them through the eyes of God's love. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 5 and 6, Peter show the connection between our relationship to God and others. He says, likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you, be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. The New Living Translation renders the verse like this. In the same way, you younger men must accept the authority of the elders. And all of you, serve each other in humility. See that? All of you, serve each other in humility. For God opposes the proud, but favors the humble. So humble yourselves under the mighty power of God. And at the right time, at the right time, he will lift you up in honor. At the right time. At the right time. So, Joseph was lifted up in honor at the right time. 13 years after he got his dream. David was crowned king at the right time. 13 years after he was anointed. So the fact that you are anointed doesn't mean that you are ready to be a king. Wait. Humble yourself, and nobody can stop you when God decides to raise you up. You don't have to raise yourself up. Peter had already admonished the saints to be submissive to government authorities. He did that in 1 Peter 2:13 to 17. He had admonished the slaves to submit to their masters. 1 Peter 2:18 to 25. And the wives to their husbands. 1 Peter 3:1 to 7. In the verses that we read, he commanded all the saints to submit to God and to each other. So if we have not submitted to God, we won't be able to submit to each other. We could put it this way, the proof that we have submitted to God is the ability to submit to each other. The more we submit to God, the more we will be able to submit to each other. So people who talk like this, pastor can't tell me nothing, deacon can't tell me nothing, you don't have to ask any questions. They have not submitted to God. The problem is not with the leaders. The problem is with their submission to God. No, I found that the word of God will always find us out. The younger believers should submit to the older believers, not only out of respect for their age, but also out of respect for their spiritual maturity. Of course, not every senior saint is a mature Christian, because quantity of years is no guarantee of quality of experience. The older church members should not believe that because they have been around for a long time, the younger members cannot add anything to them. Can you say amen? Too often there is a generation war in the church, with the older people resisting change and the younger people resisting the older people. The solution is twofold. One, all believers, young and old, should submit to each other. Look at the person beside you. Just look at them. And we're going to be talking to each other. Say to them, you know, it's going to be very hard to submit to you, but I will try. Number two, all should submit to God. What's the answer? The answer is be clothed. You must wear humility like your clothes. Just as Jesus laid aside his outer garments and put on a towel to become a servant, so each of us should have a servant's attitude and minister to each other. Listen to this. Humility is not demeaning ourselves and thinking poorly of ourselves. It is simply not thinking of ourselves at all. Listen, folks, we can never be submissive to each other until we are first submissive to God. Peter quoted Proverbs 3:34, that God resisteth the proud. Peter was quoting from the Bible. James in chapter 4 and 6 of his letter also quotes Proverbs 3:34. It takes grace to submit to another believer. But God can give that grace if we humble ourselves before him. God resists the proud because God hates the sin of pride. It was pride that turned Lucifer into Satan. It was pride, a desire to be like God, that stirred Eve to take the forbidden fruit. According to 1 John 2:16, the pride of life is an evidence of worldliness. Pride of life, evidence of worldliness. The only antidote for pride is the grace of God. And we receive that grace when we yield ourselves to him. The evidence of that grace is that we yield to one another. So the only way to get rid of pride is to humble ourselves, and that takes grace. It is as we submit ourselves to God that God gives us the grace to do that even more. And we can know that we have submitted ourselves to God by our ease or difficulty in submitting to each other. So, I serve as the pastor. But let us say that a member who might not be a leader, might not have any position in the church, comes to me and he or she says, "Pastor, this happened and I didn't like how you handled it. So now what must I do? Should I say, who are you? You know who I am? You know that is me, the Lord, called to be the head of this church. And if there's any problem, you will tell me. Who are you to talk to me like that? When you got saved. That would be a sign that I had not submitted to God. Now, I might not agree with what the person said, you know. But the least I need to do is to try and consider and to respect them because they have a view too. Huh? I went somewhere last night and I told the persons there, I said to them, I never speak about my church because I don't have a church. And I never speak about my sheep because I didn't die for them. They are not mine. So all of us must be clothed with humility. You know, folks, when you really know who you are, you realize you are not all that important, you know. Submission is an act of faith. It is an act of faith. Christian service is faith, you know, brothers and sisters, because you see, it's based on grace. It's not based on works. We are trusting God to direct in our lives and to work out his purposes in his time. After all, there is a danger in submitting to others. There is a danger, you know, because they might take advantage of us. A wife who submits to her husband may take advantage of that submission. But not if we trust God and if we are submitted to one another. You see, if I am submitted to Brother Estherine and he's submitted to me, it's very difficult for us to take advantage of each other. You know what I found, brothers and sisters? It is hard. Very hard to beat a man who is determined to be the lowest because he really doesn't care anymore. Hard. I found that out. If it's difficult to victimize somebody who doesn't want anything. A person who is truly yielded to God and who wants to serve his fellow Christians would not even think of taking advantage of someone else, saved or unsaved. The mighty hand of God that directs our lives can also direct in the lives of others. In every church, in every generation, there are divisive influences. There are always issues, loyalties and conflicts that can cause division. In the midst of hardships, it is easy to turn on one another. In Philippians chapter 2, 1 to 4, Paul encouraged the Philippians to agree with one another, stop complaining, and work together. Now, how Paul came to write this letter in part is that Epaphroditus, who was his messenger, he had sent Epaphroditus from Rome. Paul was in prison in Rome, and he had sent Epaphroditus to the church of the Philippians. Epaphroditus had returned from Philippi to Rome, and he had brought a great, you know, they had really sent some very strong financial help for Paul. The churches in Macedonia in general, of which Philippi was a part, they loved Paul. They supported Paul in a very significant way. And they were concerned for Paul. They really did love Paul. Unfortunately, Epaphroditus also brought the bad news of a possible division in the church family. Philippi was a cosmopolitan city like London or New York or Paris. And the composition of the church reflected great diversity with people from a variety of backgrounds and walks of life. Had all kinds of people in the church in Rome, Jews, Gentiles, wealthy people, poor people, slaves, slave masters. Even some of them that worked in Caesar's palace. All kinds of different people were in the church at Rome. So, and if you read Acts 16, you will see the diverse makeup of the church. There was Lydia, who was a seller of purple. She was probably the first convert. Very wealthy lady. There was, thinking likely that the servant girl whom Paul cast the devils out of might have joined the church. And the Philippian jailer, he became a part of the church. So just there alone you have different people with so many different backgrounds among the members. Unity must have been difficult to maintain, because these are human beings, you know, folks. We have to recognize that, eh? In Philippians chapter 4, verse 2, Paul sent a personal word to Euodia and Syntyche, two female saints in the church. The King James Version, you see the word Euodius, but it should be Euodia, because Euodius is a male name. Female name is Euodia. And brethren, may I just say, I'm not telling you to do like me, but when I am reading the Bible or studying, I generally, when I'm reading a chapter, I read it from the four different translations that I've given you, so that I kind of get a view, because, well, let me leave that alone for now. Some things we have to deal with when we are a little more mature, when all of us are a little more mature. So Paul says to these two female saints, I appeal to Euodia and Syntyche, please, because you belong to the Lord, settle your disagreement. See what Paul appeals to? Because you belong to the Lord, settle your disagreement. What Euodia and Syntyche were debating about, Paul does not state. Perhaps they both wanted to be president of the Women's Fellowship Ministry or secretary of the United Apostolic Church of Philippi fundraising committee. I'm not sure. Paul knew that if the division in the church was not addressed quickly and thoroughly, the Philippian church would suffer incalculable harm. He understood what many Christians today do not understand, that there's a difference between unity and uniformity. And I have said this to us before. True spiritual unity comes from within. It is a matter of the heart. Uniformity is the result of pressure from without. This is why Paul opens this section of his letter appealing to the highest possible spiritual motives. You notice he said, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, I'm begging you, be like-minded. What he was saying is, if Jesus has done anything for you, live together, good man. That's always Paul's appeal. Paul never tries to pressure people from the outside. Paul never tries to get people to live for God by putting outside pressure. Know what he always appeals to? What Jesus has done for them. Romans chapter 12. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by what? The mercies of Christ, mercies of God, present your bodies. What Paul was saying, in view of all that Jesus has done for you, you must can live for him. See, Paul is always, he's saying, the thing has to be the result of a relationship. If you love Jesus and if you are grateful to him, you will live right. If you're not grateful, if you don't love God, no care where we do. Touch your neighbor and say, fall in love with Jesus, please. Since the saints at Philippi are in Christ, since they are in Christ, are you in Christ or are you out of Christ? You're not answering me. You're not sure. How many believe that you are in Christ? Stand up. You may be seated. Since the saints at Philippi are in Christ, this ought to encourage them to work toward unity and love, not division and rivalry. Remember, our subject is serving others. But we can't serve others until we have the right mindset. Because serving others is not something that we do as a result of a mechanical response. It's something that we have to do from our heart. It must be our culture to serve each other. Can't be a rule. We must do it almost as naturally as we breathe. In a gracious way, Paul is saying to the church, this is what Paul is saying, your disagreements reveal that there is a spiritual problem in your fellowship. It isn't going to be solved by rules or threats. It's going to be solved when your hearts are right with Christ and with each other. Paul wanted them to see that the basic cause of their lack of unity was selfishness. And the cause of selfishness is a lack of humility. So we've gone right back to pride. Wherever there is pride, there's going to be disunity. Anytime pride comes in, pride was threatening to destroy the witness of the Philippian church. Such a beautiful church. And that's why Paul had to move so quickly to say, no, we have to snuff this out. There can be no lasting joy in the life of the Christian who puts himself above others. It's not possible. And the lesson after this, we're going to look at the real example of humbling oneself to serve others. And that's the other part of Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 11. Because what Paul does here is give them a prescription. He says, this is what I want you to do. And then in verse 5, he stops and he says, I need to give you an example of all of this. I need to give you an example of somebody who humbled themselves in order to serve others. And then he said, oh, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And then he gives us the example of how Christ humbled himself. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 27, Paul wrote, meanwhile, live in such a way that you are a credit to the message of Christ. Isn't that wonderful? Not a debit, but a credit. You know, a debit in accounts means that there's a loss. Let nothing in your conduct hang on whether I come or not. Your conduct must be the same whether I show up to see things for myself or hear it from a distance. Stand united, singular in vision. Stand united. Stand united, singular in vision. Contending for people's trust in the message, the good news. The word contending is the translation of a Greek word which in its full meaning refers to an athletic contest in which a group of athletes cooperates as a team against another team, working in perfect coordination against a common opposition. Paul says, contending for people's trust in the message and the good news. He doesn't mean fighting a war and tracing people who don't believe what we believe. That's not what contending means. He says, I want all of you in the Philippian church to work as a team, cooperate with each other, so that the good news, the gospel, people won't have anything bad to say about it. Work together as a team. Paul is exhorting the members of the Philippian church to work together in perfect coordination, just like a team of Greek athletes. As Christians, we should not contend with one another, but unite against a mutual enemy. Who is our mutual enemy? Huh? Who is our mutual enemy? The devil. Not your brother in the church. Not somebody from another denomination. The devil. When we are united in love, Christ's strength is most abundant. We must endeavor to keep before us the ideals of teamwork, consideration of others, and unselfishness. The exhortation in Philippians 1:27 is elaborated upon in Philippians 2:2, which is our text that we read. Fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. This plea for unity that Paul begs for, he asks for it. It was given in view of four facts that are stated in verse 1. And it should be obeyed by the Philippians because of these four facts. And we're going to spend a little time looking at them. The first fact is that there is a certain consolation in Christ. Let's go back to Philippians chapter 2 and verse 1. Put that up for me. I need to show you something. See? All right. See that word, if? See that word, if? See the first word, if? Go to the King James. Let's see if it's the same word there. See that word there, if? What does that word convey to you? Conveys to you that there's a chance that it could be, if not. That's not what it means in the Greek. That's right, Sister Winsome. In the Greek, it means since, or in view of the fact. It is not something that is arguable. It is an established fact. Paul is saying, since there is consolation in Christ, since there is comfort of love, since there is. Okay? So it's since. So that's why I said it's based on four facts. And the first one is consolation in Christ. Now the Greek word consolation, or the Greek word that is rendered consolation, can mean exhortation. And that's how most of the commentators seem to look at it. But it can mean encouragement. And the context seems to favor the meaning of helping or strengthening. So what was Paul really saying? He was saying the wonderful life that our Lord lived while he was on earth should be an exhortation and an encouragement to the Philippian saints to live in a state of harmony among themselves. Since Christ, through the Holy Spirit, indwells the Christian and is desirous of living out in the Christian the same wonderful life he lived on earth. So Paul is saying, I want you to fulfill my joy. I want you to live in agreement and in unity with each other. And one of the reasons why I'm asking you this is because when Jesus Christ was here on earth, he lived a beautiful life. And the same Jesus Christ who lived that beautiful life on earth is living inside you. And he wants to live out that same life in you that he lived. The same life that he lived while he was on earth is the life that he wants to live in you. Isn't that something? So Paul says you really should be able to live in unity, you know, if you have Jesus in you. We're going to see something as we go a little further down, though, that may prevent that. The second fact is that there is a comfort of love. The exhortation and encouragement for, I love this, for the Philippians to live in unity should come from their recognition of God's love for them. Comfort of love. Their realization of the divine love which reached down and saved them should urge them to live in a spirit of unity with one another. When you think about the love that reached down to you and saved you, that should say to you, live good. That's what Paul is saying. In addition to that, this same divine love produced in the hearts of the Philippian saints by the Holy Spirit should cause them to so love each other with a love that impels them to sacrifice themselves for each other. Because it is an agape love that God has put in our hearts. The differences they experience among each other will be ironed out. And they will live in unity with one another. Remember, we said earlier in the lesson that this ability to live with each other and submit to each other is an evidence that we have submitted to God. I love that. Love that. I'm reaching for that in my spirit. The third fact is that there is a fellowship of the Spirit. The Greek word translated fellowship speaks of a common interest and a mutual and active participation in the things of God, in which the Christian and the Holy Spirit are joint participants. So Paul appeals to the Philippians to be like-minded in view of the fact that each of them participates with the Holy Spirit in a common interest and activity. We are serving the same God. We are fighting the same enemy. We are preaching the same message. We are going to the same place. We have the same, it was the same blood that washed us. And the Holy Spirit is telling us all these things. So Paul is saying, if each saint is interested in the things of the Spirit, there should naturally follow a unity among the Philippians. But you see, each saint is not interested in the things of the Spirit. Some saints are interested in the things of the flesh. And by flesh, I don't mean sex only. I mean self. It's all about self. I must have my rights. In the church, you don't have no right. The only obligation you have, the only right you have is the right to love one another. So one might ask, here's the problem I mentioned. One might ask here, if each saint has received the Holy Spirit, why is there not that unity among the saints of which Paul speaks? The answer is that this joint participation in a common interest and this mutual and active participation in the things of God are produced by the Spirit, not by virtue of his indwelling, but by virtue of his control over the Christian. So it's not just the fact that the Holy Ghost lives within me. That won't guarantee that I live like a Christian. A lot of us have the Holy Ghost. All over the world, a lot of people have the Holy Ghost. But live like a devil, fight, quarrel. The trouble in the Philippian church was that all the saints were not living spirit-controlled lives. They had the Holy Ghost. If they had been, there would have been unity. It is not for us to ensure that we have the Holy Spirit. We must ensure that the Holy Spirit has us. We don't even talk about the Holy Spirit right. You know? We don't even talk about the Holy Spirit right. We will ask people, you get it? So the Holy Spirit is a it. You get it yet? You not get it yet? Look how long you are tarry and you not get it. How insulted the Holy Spirit must be. Oh, Holy Spirit is Christ in us, hope of glory. But we say, I've got it. Well, it needs to get you then. All of us, not enough to say we receive the Holy Ghost. We need to go on to be able to say, I am controlled by the Holy Ghost. I just don't have him. He has me. So, speaking in tongues and dancing and singing and preaching under the anointing, these may just be signs that we have him. That's not a sign that he has us. When he has us, we will speak the truth. When he has us, we will love our enemies. When he has us, we will respect authority. When he has us, we will flee fornication. When he has us, there are certain things that will follow. When he has us, when we do that which is wrong, we repent and humble ourselves. So maybe when you go home today, when we go home, maybe one of the things we could examine very carefully is whether it's just we that have him, or if we can truly say he has us. When he has us, it's difficult for there to be disunity in the church. When he has us, we will have a desire to serve each other. That's the end product of humility, an ability and a willingness to serve each other. Let's lift our hands and worship the Lord. The fourth fact Paul looks at why there should be unity in the church of the Philippians is that there are bowels and mercies. The word bowels is a translation of a Greek word which means tender-heartednesses. The word mercies could be rendered compassionate yearnings and actions. These things are in our hearts when the Holy Ghost has us. He promotes these things in our hearts and in our lives. And if that is true, we will be able to live in peace. Differences will be patched up. Estrangements would be healed. Quarrels would cease. But back of all, the hindrance of these things is the monster of pride. Paul informs the saints that the secret of joy, in spite of people, is the submissive mind. Submissive mind. In verse 3, which I think is the key verse, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better, more important than themselves. Nothing in the church should be done with a spirit of contention. Christians are forbidden to do anything as the mere result of strife. We are forbidden to secure anything over others as the result of dark schemes and plans formed by rivalry or by the indulgence of angry passions or with the spirit of ambition. We are not to do anything for the purpose of showing that we have more intelligence, talent, or zeal than do others. Sadly, this rule is often violated. How often do we see Christians attempting to outstrip each other and to see which of them should be the greatest? There is no holiness in such efforts. No holiness. We're not going to have any reward. Never should this motive be allowed to influence us. Self is not to be foremost. Selfishness is not to be the motive. This admonition affects all of us. Brethren, every one of us. I am included. I am the chief of sinners. When I said chief, I don't want you to get the wrong impression. I don't mean the chief ruler. I mean the chief sinner. Is there any saint who does not in some respect desire to display himself or herself? Is there any preacher or teacher who has never desired to demonstrate how good a minister of the gospel he is? Which singer or musician is there in the church that does not have to battle sometimes not to be overcome with that desire to receive commendation from men? And we could go on and on. The truth is that if all could be taken out of human conduct, even Christian conduct, which is performed as a result of strife or vainglory, only a small portion would be left. Lowliness of mind means modesty or humility. It stands opposed to the pride which would lead us to strive for the ascendancy or to receive the praise of men. The only true antidote for these faults is humility. This virtue consists in estimating ourselves according to truth. It is a willingness to take the place which we ought to take in the sight of God and man. When we have the estimate of our own importance and character, which the truth should produce, it will motivate us to serve others sincerely and consistently. In Philippians chapter 1, what Paul stresses is Christ first. In Philippians chapter 2, what he stresses is others next. Paul, the soul winner in chapter 1, becomes Paul, the servant in chapter 2. It is important that we understand what the Bible means by humility. We noted earlier that the humble person is not one who thinks little of himself. He simply does not think of himself at all. Humility is that grace that when you think you have it, you have lost it. If you believe you are humble, that's a sure sign that you are not. Point blank, I say that without apology. If you walk around and tell people, I'm just a humble brother, you are the proudest person in the world. You don't know the first thing about humility. Because humble people have a sense that they are so proud and they have to fight against it. I'm so humble. I'm a humble little sister. You are the proudest person in the world. According to Romans 12:3, the truly humble person knows himself and accepts himself. Paul says, because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given us. That's the New Living Translation. The genuinely humble person yields himself to Christ to be his servant and to use what he is and what he has for the glory of God and the good of others. The key idea in Philippians 2 is others. Paul is trying to get the Philippian saints to turn away from themselves long enough to focus on the need of others. One of the effects, I want you to follow this, brethren. One of the effects produced by true humility is the ability to esteem others better than ourselves. I want you to follow me now. The truly humble person is acutely aware of his or her own defects, weaknesses, and failures. And perhaps because of that, they do not have the same awareness of the defects, weaknesses, and failures of others. The humble person sees his or her own heart and is conscious of the great corruption there. They are well acquainted with the impurity of the motives which drive them and of the evil thoughts and corrupt desires of their own souls. They can only see the outward conduct of others, but in their own case they can look within. The genuinely humble person naturally looks at others in a more favorable light than he or she looks at themselves, for knowing how weak and sinful they are, they naturally assume that other people could not be as weak and as sinful as they. This leads them to feel that other saints are worthy of more respect than they are. A truly godly man or woman will be always a humble man or woman and will desire that others be preferred to themselves. This rule of Christianity should eliminate all ungodly ambition and should make it very difficult for us to have a love of office and position. So, see how it works, brethren? Because I know deep within my own struggles, my own failures, my own proneness to sin, my own waywardness. When I look at others of God's people, I said to myself, there's no way he or she has given God as much trouble as me. No way, it's not possible. I I know you have to be very, you have to be very careful, and I've always said this, well, thought it, we have to be very careful of judgment in the church. We have to be very careful, you know. You, for instance, will have this young lady, she's in the church, you know, maybe just got a little careless, did what she shouldn't do, and she comes and she's pregnant. That's kind of obvious, right? So then it's not too difficult for us to judge her. And maybe in some churches, she's a spectacle, you know, put up there and, you know, is judged by the church. But sitting in the congregation are some sisters who are doing the same thing that she did to get pregnant, you know, only thing they are protecting themselves. How dare they even think to sit in the same church when the judgment is being handed down? Are they any better? No, by no rule of thumb. Well, they might be a little smarter. No, you have to be careful how you administer things in church. Because sometimes, even the same thing, you can't judge it the same way, you know. Well, that's how I think anyway. So I think. See, the thing with God, you, brethren, I really love Jesus, you know. Not enough, but I love Jesus. And the reason why I love Jesus is because he knows all the little nuances. See, when Jesus judges, he takes into consideration all the factors that led up to the thing. See, we only see the sin. That's all we see. We don't see the wrestling before. We don't understand that this person has a proclivity to sin in this area because of something that happened long time ago in his or her life. We don't see the wrestling, while there are others who just do it, never even try to fight. You know, the Bible said that Eve was deceived by the serpent, but Adam was not deceived. That's what makes Adam sin so terribly, you know. Adam sinned understanding what he was doing. He knew that it was wrong. Eve was deceived. But Adam went into the thing cold-bloodedly. That's different, you know, brethren. But you see, the only person who knows all those little differences is God. That's why I thank God that he's the one who makes the final judgment. Because whatever we do wrong, God is going to set it right. And the reason why we are so proud is because we really don't know ourselves. I told you that I was somewhere last night, and I believe that Jesus Christ can, there's no sin, no tendency that he can't deliver people from. And brethren, I honestly believe that, you know. So I said to the ministers there, if you believe that there is a sin that Jesus Christ cannot deal with, you need to surrender your credentials. You are not worthy of the name of minister. You cannot truly preach the gospel. You cannot. You cannot. You cannot be a preacher of the gospel, if there's one thing that is a prerequisite for a preacher of the gospel, you must believe in the grace of God. If you don't believe in the grace of God, and I said to them, if God can save you, he can save anybody, because you not better than anybody. I believe that with all my heart, you know, brethren. And I'm going to defend that. See, if I should be looking for the praise of men, I can't be the servant of the Lord. I'm not really concerned about what people think of me. What I'm concerned about is that I am a faithful minister of the gospel. So, you know, brethren, I must tell you this. One of the things that astonishes me, it's remarkable to me, and I accept it as a fact because the Bible says so. And it's the fact that Jesus Christ loves me. I can't get over that, you know. I can never. I'm always in wonderment. I can't just take it for granted. It just looked to me so strange. It blows my mind. And I want to say this. This is not, of course, not in the notes, but I think I need to say it. When Jesus Christ forgives, he forgives utterly. You understand that? If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. And not only that, to cleanse us. So when we confess our sins, you might feel that you are not forgiven, you know, but your feeling cannot undo what God has legally done. God has set you free. If you still feel condemned, it's not God's fault. The record is clear. Bible says that if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our hearts. God doesn't depend on how you feel to decide whether you are forgiven or not. He says it's done. And all he says, accept it. So if you do not believe you are forgiven, it doesn't cancel out what God has done. It just prevents you from walking in victory. See, folks, see, God is against works of righteousness as far as our standing with him is concerned. We do works of righteousness not to earn points with God, but because we are his. What else can we do? Your good work can't earn your favors with God. It can't bribe God to love you more. Your good works must be a loving response to a God that you are so grateful to for saving a wretch like you. How can I live any other way? Forgiveness of sins is a judicial act of God. It's a legal thing. When God forgives, it is so. Whether you accept it or not, the record is cleansed. How God sees you is the way he saw you when you just got the Holy Ghost. When God forgives us, he doesn't look at us with any baggage in his mind. Oh, this is the 110th time that she has done the same thing. Look how much time she do the same thing. You know what? I will forgive you this time, but not like the first time. No! Every time is like the first time. what the Bible says. I don't care what they told you. I don't care what you believe. I'm telling you what the Bible says. And that does not mean that you must go and sin, because God will forgive you. That's grieving the Holy Ghost. And you will certainly pay a price for that. Lift our hands and thank God. Oh, my. When we are able to think of others as better than ourselves, it will be easier for us to look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Here we have an example of how true humility is demonstrated. Instead of concentrating on self, each Christian should be concerned for the interests of others in the household of faith. A preoccupation with self is sinful. There is always a temptation, always, it's in all of us, including me, to operate in a spirit of rivalry, looking to advance our own agenda. Such pride and selfishness is avoided by counting others more significant than ourselves. Everyone naturally looks out for his or her own interests. The key is to take the same level of concern and apply it also to the interests of others. Humility demands that we live with a genuine concern for the well-being of others, and that their interests, their needs, their struggles, their pain, their fears, and their spiritual maturity play a big part in our own life. Every Christian is expected to fulfill Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 to 3. And this is the message rendering. Live creatively, friends. If someone falls into sin, forgivingly restore him, saving your critical comments for yourself. You might be needing forgiveness before the day's out. Stoop down and reach out to those who are oppressed. Share their burdens and so complete Christ's law. If you think you are too good for that, you are badly deceived. In Romans 12, 9 to 16, Paul gives us a description of how the normal Christian life should be lived relative to others. Don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Can I say that again? Don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. Never be lazy. That's especially should be true of men. Never be lazy. But work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble and keep on praying. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Be happy with those who are happy. And weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. And don't think you know it all. Condescend to men of low estate, the King James Version says. Don't be wise in your own conceits. Those who have a desire to walk in the path of lowliness will eventually discover within them a compulsion to genuinely and consistently minister to others. In the kingdom of God, the way to become great is to serve others. You believe that, brethren? How many believe that? Not many. So we have a big problem. Our Lord emphasized this in Matthew 20:25-28. This is what he says. But Jesus called them together and said, you know that the rulers in this world lord it over their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must become your slave. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Frederick Mayer, an English Baptist pastor and evangelist, made the following observation. I used to think that God's gifts were on shelves, one above the other, and that the taller we grew in Christian character, the more easily we should reach them. I find now that God's gifts are on shelves, one beneath the other, and that it is not a question of growing taller, but stooping lower. And that we have to go down, always down, to get his best gifts. In Christian service, the branches that bear the most fruit hang the lowest. Jesus acted out this spiritual principle in a very effective way in John 13:1-17. Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come and that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil, having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he was come from God and went to God, he's giving us an example of serving others. He riseth from supper, laid aside his garments, and took a towel, and girded himself. After that, he poureth water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? It was too much for Peter. See, deep inside Peter's heart, there was a feeling that he should have been the one. Every one of them felt that way when Jesus came to them. Immediately when they saw Jesus, lay aside his garment and take the towel. All of them knew that they were guilty. Because none of them felt that they were low enough to do that. Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do, thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. You don't understand now, Peter, but you will understand. Peter saith unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. Peter says, no, Lord. It has gone too far. All right, we didn't do what you said. I should have washed all the feet. I didn't do it. All right, but let it stop now. I think this has gone too far. We understand. We get the point. I could never allow you to wash my feet. It would be a disgrace for you to wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Simon, Peter saith unto him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus saith unto him, he that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but is clean every whit. And ye are clean, but not all. For he knew who should betray him. Therefore said he, ye are not all clean. So after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments, remember he said to Peter, you shall know hereafter. He's going to let him know now. And was set down again. He saith unto them, know ye what I have done to you? Do you understand? You call me Master and Lord. And you say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If you know these things, happy are you if you do them. The secret is not just to know. The secret is to do. If you know it, then you must do it. The servant is not greater than his master. If I have washed your feet, nothing for you to wash each other's feet. Now Jesus was demonstrating to his disciples what he expected from their lives. He expected them to follow in his steps by loving and serving others. By washing the feet of his disciples, Jesus was not necessarily instituting a new church ordinance. He wasn't saying, when you have communion service, just wash at each other's feet as a ritual. Sometimes I wonder if we should do it or not, because if we don't do it in the right spirit, it's a waste of time. If we don't understand the background and the significance, might as well we don't do it. He wasn't just giving us another religious ritual to observe. No. He was giving us a principle. That's what he was doing. He wasn't saying, when you eat communion service, make sure you wash foot after. No, he was saying, make sure that you serve each other all the time. I'm just giving you an example here that I, your Lord and Master, could wash your feet. So if I can wash your feet and serve you, if I can stoop down, I who made you, can wash your feet. You who are nothing, you know, can wash the other nothing feet, two nothing washing feet, nothing wrong with that. Two sinners washing each other's feet. What could be wrong with that? If I, the righteous one, have washed your feet, what if you wash another sinner's feet? Serve each other. True servant of God must possess humility and must be characterized by a willingness to be a slave and serve each other. Christians come into humility as their concern for God and others and their devotion to God and others increases. As we become more involved in the lives of others, we become less consumed with ourselves. The converse is true. When pride dominates us, we are preoccupied with ourselves and have very little concern, if any, for others. Rather than serve others, we will seek to be served. Alexander McLaren, a Scottish nonconformist minister, said, "Our humility must not only be a lowly estimate of ourselves, but it must be a practical stripping off of distinctions and prerogatives and an identifying of ourselves with the lowliest. It must lead to service. That service must have for its end our brother's cleansing. The humble mind thinks not of its claims on others, but of its duties to them." The Apostle Paul is a great example of one who had a servant's heart. He continually in his letters identified himself as a bond slave of Jesus Christ and spent his entire ministry serving others and meeting their spiritual, emotional, physical, and economic needs. How many times in the Bible do you find Paul saying, "I'm passing through to receive the offerings you have for the poor saints in Jerusalem"? What he endured for the sake of those to whom he ministered is phenomenal. Paul took Jesus very seriously. When he heard that our Lord said, "The servant is not above his master," he said, "That's me." There was nothing that Paul was not prepared to do and to suffer for others so that he could honor the one who had called him. We will consider just one of the passages which reveals Paul's great love for people and his willingness to serve them. You don't have to comment on these verses, you know, but it's just to read them. 1 Thessalonians 2:1-12. Listen to this, New Living Translation. "You yourselves know, dear brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not a failure. You know how badly we had been treated at Philippi." Remember at Philippi, he and Silas had been beaten and thrown into the prison. Remember that? That's what he's talking about. "You know how badly we had been treated at Philippi just before we came to you, and how much we suffered there. Yet our God gave us the courage to declare his good news to you boldly in spite of great opposition. So you can see we were not preaching with any deceit or impure motives or trickery. For we speak as messengers approved by God to be entrusted with the good news. Our purpose is to please God, not people. He alone examines the motives of our hearts. Never once did we try to win you with flattery, as you well know. And God is our witness that we were not pretending to be your friends just to get your money. As for human praise, we have never sought it from you or anyone else. As apostles of Christ, we certainly had a right to make some demands of you. But instead, we were like children among you. We loved you so much. Or we were like a mother feeding and caring for her own children. We loved you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news, but our own lives too. Don't you remember, dear brothers and sisters, how hard we worked among you? Night and day, we toiled to earn a living so that we would not be a burden to any of you as we preach God's good news to you. You yourselves are our witnesses, and so is God, that we were devout and honest and faultless toward all of you believers. And you know that we treated each of you as a father treats his own children. We pleaded with you, encouraged you, and urged you to live your lives in a way that God would consider worthy, for he called you to share in his kingdom and glory. Paul's sacrificial devotion to these people is obvious. His love, concern, and burden drove him relentlessly. He cared deeply. He was willing to follow the example of his Lord and Master, who gave his life a ransom for many. This is the mindset and commitment that every one of us should have. The following story was published in 1987 in Mountain Movers, an Assemblies of God magazine. Richard Sobotka is 23 years old. He suffered from Reye's syndrome at age 9. This illness causes swelling of the brain tissue, leaving irreversible damage. Its effect on Richard has been loss of speech abilities and some motor skills. He breathes through a tracheotomy tube. These might seem to be great disabilities, but Richard has learned to serve the Lord with what he has. Last fall, he decided to collect the fallen walnuts from the grove on his parents' property. He would sell the walnuts and earn some money. Richard spent one full week gathering walnuts. This was a great task, as his disabilities prevent stooping. He sat on the ground, palming the walnut with two operational fingers. Just two of his fingers are working. Then dropping them into bags. His harvest was impressive. 270 pounds of walnuts were collected in 16 to 20 tow sacks. Richard took the walnuts to a local huller and received $21.60 for his labors. Instead of keeping the money for personal use, he decided to send it to missionaries, Bill and Judy Kirsch in South Africa. Bill wrote that the offering may well be the most generous offering we have ever received. In many ways, Richard is an example to us all. He models the kind of servanthood and self-sacrifice that pleases Christ and that we so often in our abundance and health neglect. Some of us are healthy, but we wouldn't think of giving anything to the work of the Lord. It is sad to note that in the church today, we have many celebrities, but very few servants. There are many who want to exercise authority, but few who want to take the towel and basin and wash feet. The key to greatness is not found in position or power, but in character. Instead of using people, we are to serve them. The mission of Jesus was to serve others and to give his life away. We must identify with Jesus Christ in his service and suffering, For even he could not reach the throne except by way of the cross. Let's stand and worship the Lord for a little. A lot of the problems we have because we are so consumed with self. If we thought of others more, it would be easier for us to be satisfied. We looked on the things of others sometimes. It's always me. Always me, or always me. At some point in time, brethren, we have to grow up and realize that the baby Christianity is not enough. We have to get down and deal with hardcore Christianity. Speaking in tongues and dancing and running, that's the easy part. Singing and preaching, that's the easy part. Wearing of the right garments, that's the easy part. You don't even have to be safe to do that. You don't even have to be safe to do that. There are people that speak in tongues that are not saved. There are people that speak in tongues and they have a familiar spirit. They don't have the Holy Spirit and they run the aisle too. There are people that dress modestly that don't even serve God. But now when you talk about serving others genuinely, humbly.